This is my personal RV8 here. This will be 28. Lynn Bond's over there. It's been stuck here for about 6 months. It got caught up in the Direct2 Avionics bankruptcy. He bought two Chelton panels, and he's having to buy a third Chelton panel. Who needs three? Well, he didn't get the first one, second one. So that poor airplane has been sitting here all winter waiting for this bankruptcy. Unfortunately, a lot of people have gotten caught up in that. But Lynn Vaughn's a Southwest pilot. I'm basically a beach bum, unemployed, and I'm trying to put my airplane together here on part-time. This is my panel over here that came from Bill Pippin in Fredericksburg. It's a basic panel. I've got True Track Horizon and Heading Bug with GPS in here. I've got a 396 panel dock, an SL30, which monitors two frequencies. I think this is real important for a basic panel. I can come in here across the lake. We've got a lot of student training here, plus we have Navy Air Force Joint Reserve Base over there, which flies all kinds of Navy airplanes. I can monitor either Navy or get my ATIS and winds from Meacham or Alliance Airport over there. Plus, I never miss a call on the local frequency here, which is 123.05. So I can hear the trainer, 150s or Cherokees or whatever they are. So this is a very good radio for anybody, but especially people on a budget, because I can listen to two frequencies at the same time, plus it's got the flip-flop. You just push the little thing, you can transpose the numbers. The transponder is just didn't get delivered yet. It's a basic Garmin 327 transponder. Basic instruments, that's a G-meter to check my landings. And this is a True Track autopilot. It's a Digitrack 2. It's the most bang for the buck. I think that I can fly my airplane and get to 10,500 without having to push a button to get it to do it for me. I'm totally capable of that. I can get within 200 or 300 feet of it anyway. So Digitrack 2, altitude hold, follows the GPS and or a course heading, and it holds altitude. So it really does everything I want it to. This is a fuel computer. I have no idea what it'll do or how it works, but Danny King insisted that I get this thing. So Danny being our go-to guy, we've got we've got the extra, I don't know how much, oh my God, how much it cost thing in here. Danny, I hope you'll teach me to use it. Advanced gauges for fuel, advanced gauge for volts, outside air temperature, so I can now use my temperature thing and to get true airspeed. I don't care about that. I'm really looking for ground speed, but we got CHT and EGT here, and the EI gauges for RPM and manifold pressure. Basic panel. I think I'll get one of those Walmart $4.99 stick-on compasses. That's you can't have a plane without a compass, so it's going to have one of those basic. And I can show you that in Shooter over there, too. It's got a $4.99 compass from Walmart. And that's legal. All right. This messy table here is Jim Vroom's table. I want everybody to see that. Or I don't want anybody to see it, but it's in the picture. I can't help it. All right. Vroom is just about finished with this. When the panel is all done and all wired in, and actually Chuck is due in here today, this being Wednesday, the 5th of April, I think. When this is done, then we put on the skin. When the skin's riveted on, then we put on the glass in the windshield, get screws up here and fiberglass across here. And once that's done and sanded and fit and all good, we start the final assembly and put the wings on. So this guy is almost done. The wings have already been the first fitting. This RV8 over here, mine, has not had the wings fit, and I do got a few little jobs to do, but it's not the end of the world. We'll hopefully have it flying in a few months. Lynn's airplane, like I said, is in the process of being waiting on the panel that is tied up in bankruptcy. He thinks that it was delivered recently in the last few days, and he's going to go up to Stein. Stein's building it. Stein has nothing to do with the bankruptcy. He's a good guy. Anyway, we'll have that panel back here in a couple months and be finishing and flying that one. I got two spaces here that I rent out to guys. This is James. James is RV-7. Those are Lynn's wings, but James is in the middle of doing his RV-7 tail here. And he actually works mid-gray shift. So he's usually in here about 7 in the morning and works till noon, and then he goes home and goes to sleep for a few hours. All right, so that's his toolbox there and his bins for his workshop for his nuts and bolts, screws, rivets, what have you. There's some air hoses for him to use or anybody else. That hose will go all the way out and go next door if I want to fill up a tire on the ramp. These are Lynn Bond's wings. You got wings all over the place. We can't help that. This is an interesting story over here. The guy's building this airplane. All right, this is, I think, this is serial number 44. This is an antique RV-8 that has yet to fly. Tom Bolbach's American Airlines. I believe he is they said he's the first officer. Is that a co-pilot? I know he flies with my pilot friend over here on the MD-80 occasionally. They team up. Tom comes in occasionally. Actually, I see him about once a month. He comes in and pays the rent, because I rent space here. And he'll work for an hour or two, and then I don't see him for a month. So he's been working on this airplane 9 years. He just flipped over 9 years. You can see he's pretty far along. He's finished the panel and what have you. But he hadn't been with me for 9 years. The plan is eventually, if I ever get caught up with some of these others, for me to help him with the cowling and a few other, maybe the baffling, the cowling, you get some of this stuff. And he's got wheel pants. He doesn't like much to fly. I told him, I said, if you get out of the way and get your checkbook out, I have this thing flying in about a month. Of course, that's really not the spirit of what we do here. We try to get the owners to participate to a greater degree. All right. That ought to kind of cover what we're doing here, Dougie. Why don't we go in the shop and we'll talk about tools and some of that kind of stuff. Good morning, Vietnam! Hi, Dougie. Okay, we've had a little introduction to the shop in the first section, and we're going to go come into the shop here. And I might say that this is Texas. We have pretty mild weather, but it's really nice to be able to heat it and cool it, especially heat it when you're doing a canopy. I went to a place called Home Depot. Now, I don't know if Home Depot's all over the United States, but these plastics, Bob Avery had a door like this in his shop, and because they were running back and forth between the packing and the shipping and the packing and the shipping and the parts bins, and they were walking through these things, and he had one side air conditioned and one side not air conditioned. And Home Depot runs a forklift through theirs when they're moving pallets of grass or weeds or whatever they sell at Home Depot over in the garden section if you go over there. So I went down to the plastic place, which Bob knew. We bought these curtains. And of course, this was a few years back when I did this. This is a perfect shop for an RV-8. Be careful, Doug. That thing's getting trippy. Okay. This door is 10 feet wide, and I can run an RV-8 or an RV-6 right back through here. Now, that Van Grunsven, I didn't know you were going to build a 10. It won't fit in here. Or a 7A. It won't fit in here. If I'd have known you're going to come up with 7A, my ceiling's not high enough. So I can't put the vertical stab on a 7A, and I can't even get a 10 in here. It's too wide.